Hello everyone. I'd like to talk to you today about an absolutely amazing document, the famous Sarajevo Haggadah, which is an absolutely incredible work of medieval Jewish art, one of the earliest illuminated manuscripts that we have in the Jewish tradition, but it also has an absolutely amazing and rather spooky story that's associated with its discovery, and also this unusual ability that it seems to have to protect its protectors. Let's have a quick look at the document itself. It came to light first in 1894 when an impoverished Jewish child in the town of Sarajevo, which was then part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. You may recall it, perhaps, that is the place where Archduke Ferdinand was assassinated in 1914. This child came to school with this quarto volume, about 6x8, like the size of a largest paperback book, and because his father had recently passed away, the family was impoverished, and the child was hoping to sell this document because the child knew it was valuable. It was, of course, an amazing find because it was a 500-year-old Haggadah that had originally come from Spain. So the name Sarajevo Haggadah is a little bit of a misnomer. That's where it was discovered in the modern era, the contemporary period, but it really comes from Spain, and most likely from the region of Aragon, where it may have been a wedding present. It may have been something associated with two very wealthy Jewish families who had the Haggadah commissioned, and as is common in medieval illuminated manuscripts, the actual faces of the people in the artwork may correspond to actual members of the family. But at any rate, once this document became known to the scholarly world, of course, it was avidly studied because it is a rather amazing example of Jewish art in a period when there was comparatively little figurative representative art that still exists. You'll recall the bird's head Haggadah, which had showed great hesitation to represent human features. The Sarajevo Haggadah has no such compunction, and people are regularly depicted. Here you can have a look at some of the amazing scenes in this little volume. Here's a scene that shows Moses and Aaron before King Pharaoh, who looks a little bit like a medieval Christian monarch. And the staff of Aaron, of course, is able to swallow up the staff of all the magicians of Pharaoh, as is depicted in the book of Exodus. So here is another picture that shows a large vegetable, massive vegetable, perhaps justifying the outsized Passover prices. And this appears to be maror. I'm guessing that looks like sort of like an artichoke, maybe a romaine leaf. But at any rate, it's a really big one. And here's a great picture showing the prophetess Miriam with the women dancing after the Jews are rescued from the Sea of Reeds, and the Pharaoh's soldiers are all drowned in the waters. But here's an image that is especially fascinating, and that art historians have had a great amount of difficulty figuring out exactly what's going on here. It appears to be a Seder meal. Note that all the participants are female, so it appears that the men and women must have eaten separately. The woman on the far right seems to be leading the Seder. Maybe she's making Kiddush there because she's holding up the wine cup and everyone else is waiting for her. She is clearly leaning to the left. You can see the pillow under her left elbow. And that's all fascinating in itself, but look at the woman at the lower left, who has clearly African features, and in this particular representation, her face seems to be kind of bluish. In other photographs, it looks a little bit darker, but she's clearly not of the same background as the Caucasian women in the picture, but she's clearly participating in the meal. She's holding up what looks like either a goblet or perhaps a piece of matzah there, and she's looking to the leader of the Seder like everyone else. She's seated like she's a guest at the table. She's not a servant or anything like that, even though she appears not to be related to the women. So exactly who is this dark-skinned woman at the Passover Seder? Is she a member of the household? That's what it appears. Is she a guest? What is going on? So I want to let you know in advance, I don't have an answer to that question yet, but I want to leave you with the question for now. At any rate, what happened to this Haggadah? Most likely it left with the Jews of the Iberian Peninsula with the Alhambra decree of 1492 when the Jews were expelled. We know that it made its way to Italy because we have a brief Italian statement by a censor from the year 1609 that indicates that the book is acceptable for circulation or for use. It doesn't have to be, you know, burned or anything like that. God forbid that was many of the medieval works, Hebrew works, were exposed to at this time. And then it somehow makes its way to Sarajevo, which is, of course, on the other side of the Adriatic Sea. Now, what's fascinating about this is that when the Nazis came into the region, they were, of course, aware of this great treasure, the Sarajevo Haggadah. And they specifically sought to confiscate it and then send it to their proposed museum for Jewish culture, which was not a museum where you would go and feel good about all the great things that Jews have done culturally. It was a museum to commemorate the Nazi heroic, quote-unquote, success in eradicating this culture. And they were collecting all kinds of artworks from all around Europe to try and populate this museum, and of course they wanted the Sarajevo Haggadah. There was a Muslim man named Dervish Korkut, who was the curator at the time, and he was aghast with the idea that the Nazis would actually take this document. He had apparently earlier on in his life seen the Nazis burn a Sefer Torah, and this horrified him. He felt that this was a terrible tragedy, and so he actually smuggled the Haggadah out of the museum under his shirt. He was actually inquired, the commandant asked him for this particular document while he was holding it, and he said that he had already turned it over to a lower Nazi official, and he managed to get away with this. He brought it to an imam out of town who hid it, most likely in a mosque among other Islamic books, and it managed to survive the war there until it was eventually reunited with the collection in Sarajevo, where it is a world-class treasure. Now, there's another element to this story besides the heroic thing that Mr. Korkut did by saving this Jewish treasure. He also saved a young Jewish partisan named Mira Papo. He and his wife, Servet, actually took this woman who had fled from the Nazis into their home and had her live in their home for several months, posing as a Muslim servant. So they actually had this Jewish girl. They gave her some very basic training and how she was supposed to behave and so on if the Nazis should ever come, and she managed to survive the war. In the end, she eventually moved to Israel, where she successfully nominated the Korkut family to be members of the Righteous of the Nations. And in fact, he was so recognized posthumously by Yad Vashem, and a certificate was sent to his family in Sarajevo. So that's kind of an amazing story, how this man was so heroic and saved not only the Sarajevo Haggadah, he also saved, amazingly, a young Jewish child and was recognized. But the story does not end there. What ended up happening is, those of you who remember the 1990s, it was a terrible war in Bosnia-Herzegovina. The term ethnic cleansing was really coined at that time, where Muslims and Serbs fought a bitter and brutal war. And Muslims were under attack in Serbian regions, and the descendants of the Korkut family, their daughter, had to flee the region, and she eventually made her way into Macedonia. They were impoverished, they were literally refugees with nothing to their name. All they had was a suitcase with a few belongings that they were able to gather up and take with them when they fled their apartment in the fighting that was going on. Among the documents that Korkut's daughter took with her was this certificate from Yad Vashem naming her parents as the Righteous of the Nations. And so, not knowing what to do, they made their way to the Jewish community, and they went to the Jewish Community Center, and they presented this folded up document to give some kind of indication as to what their background were. Of course, the Jewish community was overwhelmed to have a daughter of one of the righteous of the nations visiting them, and they immediately contacted Israel and the prime minister, who was at the time Benjamin Netanyahu, as he is right now as I'm giving this brief lecture, met them at the airport and welcomed them to Israel, where they were given refuge. It's an amazing story how, you know, what goes around comes around, that this heroic Muslim was able to save this treasured Jewish document, and then later the Jews were able to save his own daughter. Let us go back to this question of who is the dark-skinned woman at the Seder table. So I will leave it to the great art historians to try and opine what possibly this could mean. But I'd like to suggest, and this is just maybe something you can discuss at your Passover Seder yourself, that woman is like the other, the guest at the table. You know, at the beginning of the Seder, we like to say, whoever is hungry, please come and eat. That's part of the Haggadah itself. Who knows why that woman is in that picture? But just as she was in the family of the people who commissioned the Sarajevo Haggadah, and just as young Mira Papo was the other, you know, masquerading as a Muslim servant inside the Korkut home, and just like the Sarajevo Haggadah itself was masquerading as Muslim books on a shelf in a mosque in somewhere in Bosnia-Herzegovina, the presence of this other, this mysterious dark-skinned woman at the Passover Seder should give us some pause to think about how we relate to others in our own life. Well, that's just stepping outside of my boundaries a little bit as a historian, but something I like to think about. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you have a fantastic Passover Seder.